stuff. And I've heard Paris Jude is notorious for sending lots of tweets, you know, during the particular job session, so we expect to see some of those. Use the hashtag of WildFly, that's what we'd love to see. I'm the director for developer advocacy at Red Hat, so anything to do with developer outreach efforts in terms of, you know, speaking at conferences, you know, building the strategy, what we should do with the JBoss particular products. You know, I work with my co-partner, who's Ray Klosky, who's more on the developer program side of it. So two of us work hand in hand. I have, as I said, you know, I've written a couple of O'Reilly books. This one is on Java E7. This is the most recent one. Actually, there's a recent one which came out literally last week, which is a Java E7 HTML5. And I kind of like doing lots of fitness routines. So if you have any special core routine or anything that works out your carbs, you know, calves or arms, anything, I'm happy to kind of exchange some notes on that. Now, Zero Turnaround is a company which is also known as the JRebel company. They do this annual survey of different application servers. As part of that, they did the survey last year where they included Tomcat, Glassfish, Cherry, JBoss, an IBM WebSphere Liberty profile. They took those servers and then they measured their metrics, you know, in the sense development, deployment, tooling, community, forums. They look at all those different options and see how each of these app servers are doing, okay? And then they graded each of the application server from 1 to 5. Now, they did not include WebLogic or WebSphere as part of the study. The idea was these are not suitable for development. So they really picked the lightweight application servers. And as part of that study last year, JBoss AS7, which is sort of what we took to the next level for WildFly, won the award, okay? And you can read this, just go to Zero Turnaround, and the report is right on their page itself. And from the report itself, it says, if we have to pick a winner, that would be JBoss, because consistently, as I said, they scored from 1 to 5. JBoss was the only application server in all different metrics where the score never fell below 4. So it was consistently 4 and up. And developers, you know, which is very, very crucial for Red Hat and JBoss specifically. Which is very, very crucial for Red Hat. And they particularly said it's shown very well in the developer profiles, you know, developer exercises. Okay? So my goal today is to talk about WildFly, which is the next version of JBoss AS7. How is it new? What is improved in it? So I'm going to talk about the new features in WildFly. And I'll also talk about some of the features that we carried forward from JBoss AS7. So as I said, JBoss AS7 was the older version. WildFly is the latest release. We're going to touch on both of those. Okay? And by all means, feel free to keep it interactive. If you have questions, feel free to ask me questions throughout the presentation. So what is WildFly 8? Now, WildFly 8 is what was, as I said, what used to be JBoss Application Server, or JBoss AS7. So after AS7, we split, you know, because there was a confusion that whether this JBoss is the open source project or is the EAP product. There was a confusion around that. So we said, okay, JBoss is going to be the EAP, which is Enterprise Application Platform, which is the product version of it. For the community project, which is JBoss AS, used to be JBoss AS, we're going to call it as WildFly because it has its own life cycle. So effectively, WildFly now is the upstream project for JBoss EAP, which is a commercial product. And the advantage of that is because WildFly can be a lot more aggressive. It can evolve a lot more rapidly. On the other hand, JBoss EAP being a commercial product, it is a lot more conservative. Now, we do lots of certifications, testing like JDK, operating system, databases, all that certifications happen on JBoss EAP. WildFly, on the other hand, is there, for example, to meet your rapid innovation needs. So Java E7 and all the cool things that you think about, you know, in the technology are first tested and tried in WildFly and then integrated into the product. And the important part from your perspective is exactly the same code base. You know, at one point of time, we take WildFly and we're going to say we're going to make this as a JBoss EAP. What comes in JBoss EAP is a bunch of bug fixes. Okay? performance enhancements, certifications, and things like that, which eventually are integrated into WildFly, but probably in a later release or so. Okay? So that's sort of one thing that you want to understand. Throughout the presentation, I hope to show you how fast it is, how lightweight it is, how manageable it is, and I'm going to highlight all of those aspects of WildFly. Developers are very, very key for Red Hat, as I said earlier. Lots of features in WildFly which are focused towards developer friendliness, and I hope to highlight some of those. Now, Java EE is sort of the main basis, you know, is the biggest audience for WildFly typically, but that is not the only audience. So think about Project Torchbox that provides Ruby on Rails experience on JBoss AS7. WildFly builds on top of JBoss AS7, so even though Torchbox, which provides Ruby on Rails experience, is not supported in WildFly, but it still leverages the core of JBoss AS7. So all the core, all the internals of Torchbox are based upon the WildFly architecture in that sense. And the biggest part, you know, which is on the DNA of Red Hat, is 100% open source. So if your application is not working for some reason, you have the entire source code of not your application, but the entire application server. So you attach it, you see, you know, what is the behavior, where is it breaking, is it a bug in the application server? If it's a bug, file a bug. You can even, you know, the entire source code is available on GitHub, which gives you the ability to even send a pull request. So we encourage participation, you know, it's all about sharing, really. So let's take a look at it. What are sort of my main features for WildFly 8 in that sense, okay? Java E7, of course, is the biggest feature. I'll provide some of the coverages for the specification. Up until JBoss AS7, we had a web server which was Tomcat-based, or JBoss Web, basically. But in WildFly, we've added a high-performance web server called as Undertow. And I'll talk about some of that. In JBoss AS7 again, there were lots of ports being exposed for EJB, for RMIOP, for JMS. In WildFly, we have really cut down the ports, two ports. One for application, one for administration. So we'll talk about that. A new feature added in WildFly is role-based access control. It gives you the ability to segregate portions of your administration to different users based upon their capabilities. So we'll talk about that, what does that mean? And along with that comes audit logging, which says, oh, I want to track this particular user, or I want to track what administration or management capabilities or operations were occurred in my WildFly instance. There's support for automated patching, which will be useful for subsequent releases and eventually used in EAP. Now, WildFly by itself is about 148 megabyte download, provides a full-fledged experience in terms of Java E7, tooling, admin console, full-blown administration layer, clustering, all of that. Sometimes you may want to have a very, very core of WildFly, which makes WildFly really modular. So we have a core distribution as well. Okay. So my goal is to kind of touch upon each of these and talk about them in detail. All right. First thing we start with is Java E7. Now this is what I call as the pancake diagram of Java E7. And in terms of that, what you see, the technologies that are highlighted in blue, for example, JSON, WebSocket, Concurrency, and Batch. Those are four brand new technologies as part of Java E7. All of those are implemented in WildFly. In addition, JAX-RS and JMS, there were significant updates made. CDI, beam validation, interceptors. So there were a bunch of technologies which literally gave a complete overhaul of the platform. The main focus of Java E7 was really to provide a more cohesive application development environment to us. So let's take a look at the first one, which is WebSocket. Okay? What is the purpose of WebSocket? So, well, first of all, let's take a look at HTTP. Now, HTTP, when it was created, or the purpose for which it was created, served very well. The purpose was sharing of information. Yes, it worked very well. 25 years ago, when HTTP was really created, nobody thought of, hey, HTTP could be used for, you know, a lot of these concurrent connections, massively, you know, parallel applications. Which was right, because nobody saw those kind of applications coming along. So now, at this point, when we are looking at those applications, HTTP architecture kind of seems a little bit restricting. So what are the issues with it? Well, first is HTTP is client-driven. In a sense, client makes a request, server receives a request, responds back, client receives a response, and that's it. Server has no way to say, client, I got something ready and I'm going to send it to you. There are hacks like reverse AJAX, comment, etc., but those are still hacks, no standard programming model. Second is, when the client makes a request and receives a response, by the time it receives a response, the TCP connection is gone. If you want to make a new request, that's a new TCP connection. Okay? So if you want to make thousands of requests per second, that means thousands of TCP connections need to be opened, you know, for each of those HTTP requests. And the third problem, or the issue, so to say, with HTTP is it's a very chatty protocol. I did a simple Hello World kind of application, which is about 11 bytes. So if you want to send 11 bytes of data from client to server and receive that response back, literally echo back, there are 643 characters that are sent back and forth between client and server. And this client was like a Postman client using Chrome browser, and server was like a WildFly server. So very standard configuration. Although HTTP specification require very less number of headers, like a couple of headers, but the moment you get browsers and application servers and proxies, then they start injecting a bunch of headers. So think about, for 11 bytes of data, you're sending 643 characters, additional characters, per message. So essentially, HTTP limitations, as we see today, is single TCP connection is a one-way protocol, client to server, and it's very chatty. Okay? Those are the exact three issues that are served very well by WebSocket. A single line definition of WebSocket, as I like to call it, is it's a full duplex bi-directional communication channel over a single TCP. Well, let's take a look at it. You know, what does it mean by a full duplex? Well, client can talk to server, server can talk to client. There is no predefined request response message pattern. So client can talk to server can talk to client independent of each other. That makes it full duplex and bi-directional. And the best part is, if you have an HTTP connection, you can upgrade that. This is a standard HTTP upgrade mechanism. Once you upgrade it to WebSocket, then the TCP connection kind of stays as is, but then the client and server really becomes peer. So the TCP connection stays open, but the client and server are peers, exchanging messages with each other as many times as they want, unless one of them says, you know what, I'm done talking, and I don't want to talk anymore. And that's sort of how WebSockets operate. Now in Java EE 7, but that's a lot of details, but to build you a simple WebSocket application, what do? JSR 356 added support for WebSocket in Java EE 7. And on the screen, what you see is a simple annotated POJO. POJO in the sense is public class check endpoint. No implements, no extends, nothing. If you want to make it as a WebSocket endpoint, you just say add server endpoint. And you specify the URI where the endpoint is listening. Okay. Now, being a server endpoint is likely receiving a request from a client. So you want to dispatch a business method on the server side. Which business method you want to dispatch? That method is identified by add on message annotation. Okay. Once you put that annotation, now WebSocket can send text data or binary data. Depending upon what message you want to receive, you can have the parameter as string, in which case it will receive the string data, or you can say byte array or byte buffer, in which case it will receive the binary data. So the method parameters could vary. And then the second parameter, the message name does not matter really, but the second parameter in the method says, this is the conversation between, or the session object, is a conversation between client and server. And with that, what you can say is, you can iterate over that object, say, you know, give me all the open sessions. Remember, this is an object between client and server. So it has some client state and some server state. So, for example, in here you're saying, client, give me the open sessions. So even though the object name is client, it should be more like conversation. So you're saying, give me the open sessions on the server. On the server, you get a list of all the open sessions. You can iterate over all the open sessions and broadcast the message to all the clients. So literally this 9 or 10 lines of code is a fully functional chat server for your Java E7 application. If you just bundle that one POJO in your WAR file, and that's about it. No deployment descriptor, nothing. That is your WebSocket endpoint. If you write WebSocket, use standard WebSocket JavaScript API, or there are client APIs, you can do all of that good magic, okay? That support is implemented in WildFly. Another new technology added to Java E7 is batch. Now batch has been available, the batch API or Spring batch API, so to say, has been available for a while, but JSON 352 added that support in Java E7. And the idea over there is an ad hoc job. You want to do it during off-peak hours. You probably want to do bulk-oriented task processing. And even in that bulk, you know, let's say you got a CSV file at the end of the day, thousands of records, you want to process them one by one, and you want to validate it, and you want to write it to a database, something like that, okay? Now, that job has to be defined by something called as a job specification language. In the first version of JSR 352, which is batch applications for the Java platform, the job specification language is defined using XML. So the short name for that is job XML. What you're seeing on my screen is job XML. And here in the job XML, for example, you're saying, this is a very canonical job. So got a logical name for this my job. This job being canonical has just a single step, okay? The job typically would have multiple steps where you could even define your workflow, you know, how these steps are interacted with each other. Now in this step, I could either have item-oriented processing, where I'm going to process chunks at a given time, or I could have an ad hoc job, which is just a one-time job, which is called as batch let. The preferred processing for JSR 352 is chunk processing, and that's what we're looking at. So it says chunk, and as I said earlier, you have a reader, a processor, and a writer. Now these three items are essentially reference to POJOs in your WAR file, which are CDI referenceable. So you literally just have to put add named annotation on them, and then they're referenceable in this expression language over here, okay? Now typically the way it works is, you receive a CSV file with thousands of records, you read a bunch of records, you will validate them, but for each read, you may not want to do write. You may want to do a bulk write. And that's where exactly the item count comes in handy. You say, I'm going to read a record, I'm going to validate it, and I'm going to aggregate it. I'm not ready to write it yet. Read, validate, aggregate. Read, validate, aggregate. And during the validation, you may say, this record is not valid, just ignore it, or don't aggregate it. But eventually the idea is, once you have done enough aggregation, and that enough being defined by item count, once you have done the aggregation, write it out. The input stream could be a file, could be a JMS stream, could be, you know, a database source. Output stream similarly could be, you know, a JMS queue or a database, doesn't matter really. All you're looking at is what's your input source is, what's your output source is, and your validator, and all of that logic is defined in your POJOs essentially. And that is implemented in WildFly as well. Now, JSR 352, 353 defines Java API for JSON processing. That's again a new addition to the Java E7 platform. Now, going back to the XML world. So in XML, for example, you have JAX-P, or Java API for XML processing, and JAX-B, Java API for XML binding. Processing is a lower level API that gives you streaming API, an object model API, or DOM API, so to say, in the XML land. JAX-B is where you take a POJO, put an annotation on it, say, I don't care, you know, how you're going to do the marshalling, unmarshalling, but do it for me. So the JAX-B runtime kicks in over there. Now in this case, this API, Java API for JSON processing, is a lower level API, which is doing JSON streaming, or not JSON streaming, but reading a JSON structure in a streaming way, or generating it in a streaming way, and similarly, reading and parsing, or parsing and generating a JSON structure in an object model way. So you can say, I want to create an entire JSON object. And that's what we're doing in this code, as a matter of fact. So for example, if you see the circle one, it says, I'm going to create a new JSON object. To that JSON object, on circle two, I'm saying, add a couple of name value pairs, because that's what JSON is. So add apple red, banana yellow, and you build the JSON object. Once the JSON object is ready, you can write it up, either to a stream or to a writer. In this case, I'm just using a writer. So the API is simple, but remember, it's a lower level API. And it's not like JSON, where you just take a POJO, put annotation on it. Hopefully, JSON binding in Java EE8 will give that higher level API, which will make it work. And that is implemented in WildFly as well. Now, Java EE being a managed environment does not allow you to run your own user threads. It does not allow it, but app server still permitted. That's not really a violation per se. But the idea is, if you run user threads, those are user threads. That means the container cannot pass any information to those threads because they are running in user context. Now, JSON 236, which is concurrency utilities for Java EE, gives you the ability to run user threads, but in a managed environment. And that's the big benefit of it. So we are used to the principles of JDK design principles like executor service or scheduled executor. So what this API adds to the platform is managed executor or managed scheduled executor. It basically adds the managed versions of those. So that's one new addition part of it. The other important part of it is all that managed objects, they are following the standard JDK design principle. So the idea being, in this code, for example, I'm creating a simple task which is implementing runnable, very standard task, you know, could be callable as well, subtle differences between the two. But once you have your task defined, could be in the class or outside the class, you're going to inject a managed executor. And you're using the standard add resource syntax. Say, just inject the managed executor for me. Now, the managed executor could be configured for thread pool, etc., all of those, but that's still app server specific right now. But once you have the managed executor, the important line is line number 3, where you're using your standard JDK design principles to submit a task. There are really just one method that is being added as part of this interface, which is managed, and that's about it. So that gives you the full ability to repurpose your existing code instead of running in user threads, running in a managed thread. And the advantage over there, your class loading, your jinding, your security context, all of that is then now available in the managed thread because the container is managing it. You are not responsible for the lifecycle of the thread. And that is implemented in WildFly as well. All right, so those were the four new additions to the Java EE7 platform: JSON, WebSocket, Batch, and Concurrency. Now, JAX-RS2, which is JSR 339, is where, again, a big chunk of improvements happened. One of the biggest additions to JAX-RS 2.0 is a brand new client API. JAX-RS, in general, has been focused up until 1.1 on being a server-side API. So what that means is, you take a POJO, put annotations on it, and bundle it in a WAR file, and that will be published as a REST endpoint. But with JAX-RS 2.0, now you can say, hey, I want to invoke a REST endpoint using a standard JAX-RS API. And that's the code fragment I'm showing here. So here, for example, you can say, client builder, build a new client. This is my entry point to the client API. Then you're going to set the target. The target is the REST endpoint where your request is being listened. Okay, that's sort of your URI. You can optionally register for a resource, saying, okay, I want this resource to be marshaled and unmarshaled on the wire. Now, once that is done, you can set up any sub-resources. So in this case, I'm saying path, specifying the sub-resource template, and then I'm resolving the template as well. Then the line number 4 says, you can specify MIME type of on-the-wire format. So like in this case, I want on-the-wire format to be application/XML. And finally, you make the HTTP GET request, which is basically identified by your GET method here. So you can do GET, you can do PUT, POST, DELETE, HEAD options. All of those standard HTTP methods are available to you as part of this client API. Now, in this case, the media type does not really matter because eventually I'm saying, hey, give me this back as a POJO. I don't care, you know, what's on the wire format. But this on the wire format would be relevant, for example, if you say, this is string.class, because then you're actually getting the exact on-the-wire format, and then you're manipulating it yourself. Not a typical use case, but you may want to do that in certain circumstances. So that's sort of a new addition to Java E7 and implemented in REST Easy in WildFly. Another major overhaul to Java E7 was in JMS. Now JMS 1.1, the last revision was in December of 2003, so almost 10 years ago. So that was the time when we had JDK 1.4. So no generics, no annotations, nothing. Nothing was in the platform at all. So the biggest role for JMS in that sense was really to catch up with the platform and bring it up to pace, up to speed with what the language changes are. So here, for example, a new annotation is added called as JMS destination definition. Typically, when you have a JMS queue running or a point running somewhere, then as part of the deployment, you would say, hey, here's my deployment script. Make sure you create this JMS resource. Now, by putting this annotation anywhere on your stateless bean or a singleton bean or a servlet, you're saying, as part of the deployment, create this destination for me automatically. Okay? Then, of course, you need to inject that annotation or the destination. So the injection is very usual. So say add resource and you inject the annotation that way. Now, JMS context, if you look at circle 2, JMS context is sort of the entry point to the new JMS simplified API. One of the key things about JMS is that it is used so widely, you could not say, hey, you know what, I'm going to take the API, shuffle it all over and make a brand new API. That API is used such a long time, you want to keep the JMS 1.1 API as is, which is called as a classic API. The new API was introduced so that it kind of looks similar, but still leveraging all the modern features. That's called as a modern API, okay? I think it's modern API, or simplified API, actually. Now, in the simplified API, JMS context is sort of your entry point. So you can say, I'm going to inject a JMS context, so we're leveraging the CDI concepts over there. Once you inject the JMS context, you don't need to specify a JMS connection factory over here because the Java E7 platform defines a default connection factory. So you use the default connection factory if you've not specified. Nothing hurts you, if you actually, or nothing protects you from adding a connection factory over there. If you have a specific connection factory that you want to use, which is configured in a specific way, by all means, you can use that. So, but the point being, once you inject JMS context, the crux of the entire JMS 2, in one short sentence for me is line 4. But I'm saying, from the context, create the producer, send the message to this destination, and this is the message. So really fluent builder API. This code, literally line 4 itself, or say line 3 and 4, would be about 25 lines of code. Because everything was a checked exception, you want to close the connection, that's a checked exception. Everything, you have to put in a try catch. Finally, finally you have a try catch. Very nasty code, very unmaintainable. You don't want to give that code. You only hope that nobody inherits that code from you. But that is now implemented in Hornet Queue and integrated in WildFly. So those are some of the major improvements. But in addition, one of the big ones that I've been thinking of adding to the slide deck itself is JTA 1.2, which is JSR 907. Now, one of the big things over there is, what does JTA define? So Java Transaction API. It defines a standard way by which you can do a transaction or inject a user-managed transaction object in any of the Java EE components. Now, CDI was such a critical piece of Java EE 6 and such a game changer in Java EE 6 that in Java EE 7, CDI was made as a default. There's a default mechanism, and it provides some knobs and turns by which you can say, I want what kind of CDI injection to happen, but by default, any POJO which is annotated with a CDI scope is available for injection, okay? Even if you don't have a beans.xml, for example. Now, along with that, one of the big changes that came as part of back to JSR 907 or JTA is, up until Java, before Java E7, actually what you could do is you could take a POJO, you could inject a user-managed transaction, manage the life cycle of it by yourself, and say, I'm going to start the user transaction, commit, rollback, etc. by yourself. But if you want to do container-managed transaction, that was only possible in EJB. Now with JTA 1.2, you can actually have user or container-managed transaction on a POJO. And what that means is, you can take a POJO, on a POJO, you can put an annotation, say, @transactional. And That means it's going to be a container managed transaction. It's not an EJP. You don't need to put add stateless. Any POJO can take add transactional annotation, and it will automatically be, the container will automatically take care of starting your transaction, committing slash rollbacking based upon the scenarios described in the specification. You don't have to confine it to POJO. You can say, hey, here's my POJO, but 10 methods, only one method is transactional. So that granularity is available. So all the semantics that were available for container managed transactions in EJB are available over here. And the way that is implemented, that is CDI. That is again a CDI acceptor binding. So CDI does a lot of magic behind the scenes, is not visible, but I mean, it's visible across different specifications. But remember, the CDI is a very, very critical piece of Java EE7. As a matter of fact, JSF 2.2 has decided to kind of deprecate managed beans. And so CDI beans is going to be the default, for example, for Java EE7. Watch, I can keep going about Java EE7 ever. Anyway, this is all implemented in WildFly. Now, in terms of the tooling, you know, if you want to try out any of the Java EE7 features, so there is NetBeans. Eclipse has a wonderful set of plugins by JBoss tools. NetBeans plugin is also built by a Red Hat employee. And IntelliJ has added support for Java EE7 in IntelliJ IDEA. And they all support WildFly. So if you want to try Java EE7, they're completely IDE agnostic, full Java EE7 support, and WildFly support in all the three major IDEs. All right, any questions so far?
Yes.
Yes.
What is the batch implementation in JBoss?
JBerret. So you can go to JBerret, J-B-E-R-E-T, and that is the implementation in WildFly. And just like, you know, JBatch, for example, which is in Glassfish, JBerret can be downloaded by itself. It is integrated in WildFly, and you can try it in a standalone mode as well.
Would that run in a JBoss 7? Of 6 EAP, you know, a down version?
I haven't tried it. Batch JSON 352, as far as I know, does not have a requirement on either servlet or any other container. So it's just like a standard, you know, running in a Java SE environment, so it should work. But take a look at JBerret. And I actually, right after I joined Red Hat, I looked at those implementations myself. And I blogged about the Java EE7 implementations in WildFly. So I have a full blog entry that explains what Java EE7 implementations, what their project names are, where you can download them by themselves. Yeah. You mean JBatch?
Yes, batching, because
it plays batching by hand. Yeah, well, I mean, remember, the first step is WildFly. That's how the upstream project. Then WildFly kind of gets converted into JBoss EAP7. So JBoss EAP7 will be, dates will be announced at DevNation or Red Hat Summit next month. And then BRMS, etc. will be based upon EAP. So when they get on based upon it, so it sort of kind of starts filtering down the product line. Absolutely, but that would be the goal.
Sorry, do you have a connection with GMS API with CDI event natively, or I need to with a new API, or I need to connect with my code myself?
So the question is, can GMS simplified API be used with CDI events?
Natively, yes.
In the simplified API, yes, I've seen some use cases where people have used CDI events with JMS, but not with the classic API, which is JMS 1.1 API, no.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I can do it myself with your tooling.
Yeah. All right. So, now that's about Java EE7. That's not the biggest sort of the driver for WildFly. But there are lots of other goodies, lots of good additions in WildFly beyond Java EE7. One of the biggest ones, you know, is of course completely overhauling, actually writing a new brand new web server, which is Undertow. Okay. Now, web server is such a critical piece, if not the most critical piece, it's such a critical piece of an application server that we have been kind of stuck, so to say, with JBoss web, or actually rather Tomcat, for such a long time, but we decided, you know what, at some point we have to kind of pull the umbilical cord out, start from ground up, and see, you know, what we can get. You know, leverage all the modern APIs, no need to have any backwards compatibility, and that's what we decided to do. And indeed, the result was it gave us an extremely flexible and a high-performance web server. It's completely, it offers you both blocking and non-blocking components using the Java NIO APIs. The architecture, you know, by itself, because it's composition-based architecture, handler-based architecture, and I'll show you in a second what do I mean by that. That's what gives me the flexibility and ability to control how I want my Undertow to look like. It's very lightweight and fully embeddable. In a sense, you can literally build the code to start up Undertow, you know, in one line, and your embedding class can control the lifecycle of Undertow. And I'll show the code in a second. Supports server 3.1, and HTTP upgrade. So it supports WebSocket as well in that case. And Undertow by itself supports mod cluster, which is sort of an advanced version of, think of mod JK, some additional benefits on top of mod JK, by which you can do proxying and load balancing and all of that using Undertow. Okay? So let's take a look at a simple code on how, what do I mean by embeddable Undertow. So here, I'm saying build a new Undertow, add a listener on localhost port 8080. I'm going to add a new HTTP handler. And so this is sort of my handler-based architecture. Whatever handlers you want to add, you have to explicitly add the handlers. I want a HTTP handler, I want a servlet handler, so you can write what your handlers are going to look like. This is just a plain vanilla HTTP handler. You're going to override the method called as handler request. You just ping this server on localhost colon 8080. It's just dumb, it's going to return back hello world to you. Okay? And on line 3, I'm saying build the Undertow and start the Undertow. What you could do is you could create an instance of Undertow, keep it, start it and stop it on demand. So that's sort of the embeddable nature of it. So it's really cool and really scalable. Now, I'm from Red Hat, so you may not believe me, but there's a company called as Tech and Power. And they've been running benchmarks for a few months now. And they've done these benchmarks for about 90 frameworks. This is sort of a loosely coined term, because to them, JSF is a framework, Spring is a framework, Apache HTTPD is a framework, Vertex is a framework, Netty is a framework. So they use the term very loosely, okay? But consider those components are being tested for benchmarking. Here is the benchmark that I saw about a couple of weeks ago. So they've done, you know, they do this 90 frameworks, so to say, they do their benchmarking testing. And these benchmarks are like, you know, simple text serialization, JSON serialization, binary serialization, do some backend database processing and all that sort of stuff. And in these benchmarks, what they do is they report certain results. Like, okay, what is the ranking of the framework in a particular benchmark? Now, in round 8, which was done about a month and a half ago, Undertow was among top 10 in all of those benchmarks. And given that it's a brand new web server, I think that's pretty impressive. Now, this came out like March 14th, so about 5 days ago, literally. March 4th, actually. I'm reading the news correctly. March 4th, it came out. And there, what they did is, they did all the tests, and they were surprised themselves. Now, what I want to highlight here is, they were able to do 31 million concurrent connections in about 30 seconds. That's more than a million concurrent connections per second. So Undertow was able to scale, and this was single instance of Undertow, no load balancing, nothing. And of course, it was a beefy server. Now, you can read all the details on their blog. It was a very beefy server, but million concurrent connections. And we have seen those numbers in our internal benchmarks, but it was very good to see that validation coming from a third party. So they've explained what their server looked like, you know, how did they configure it, but yeah, more than a million requests per second. Another feature,
does it need a JBoss container?
No, this Undertow is by itself a web server, full-blown web server. So you can go to undertow.io and you can download the web server and you can run it by itself. No relationship. So no JBoss container. But Undertow, the good part is if you download WildFly, you get Undertow as part of it, it's kind of in the plumbing. And by the way, the API that I showed, this is the same API that is actually used in WildFly for integration of Undertow. So that's the cool part, you know, hey, I don't like to say eat our dog food, but we drink our own champagne, and that's what we offer to you. Now, this particular feature is very important, port reduction, in the sense, earlier we had multiple ports, you know, one for EJB, one for RMIOP, one for JMS, but if you're going into a high density environment, this particular feature is very critical, you know. So what we have done is, using HTTP upgrade, and I think that is very cool, using HTTP upgrade, we have been able to cut down the number of ports that are exposed to 8080 for applications and 9990 for management. That means whether it's an EJB request, RMIOP request, JMS request, name it, you know, web service request, they all go over port 8080 first. And using HTTP upgrade, remember HTTP upgrade, the original design principle of HTTP upgrade was to say, hey, I'm using HTTP 1.1, now upgrade to HTTP 2.0. But that was some of the design principle, but WebSocket is leveraging that, but it's saying, yeah, keep the TCP connection as is, keep the pipe as is, but I'm gonna do a completely non-HTTP transport protocol on that, or non-HTTP application protocol on that. And that's the functionality we are leveraging. So first your EJB request or JMS request goes on port 8080, we do the handshake, and then we automatically upgrade you to the JMS protocol on top of that existing HTTP connection. So yeah, there is additional overhead for the HTTP upgrade, but only two ports. I think that is very compelling. Similarly for 9990, whether it's a JMX management, whether it's a native management, you know, whether it's a REST management, all of that goes over port 9990. And that's how we are using it in OpenShift, for example. Another new feature added to WildFly is role-based access control. As I said earlier, the feature is designed for huge deployments where you want to start categorizing, like, you know what, this is my admin console, this is a junior admin, this is a senior admin, this is a nighttime admin, and I want to start assigning what part of admin console is visible to a particular set of users. I could define even groups, say, you know what, these three users are junior admins, put them in this junior admin group. These are senior admins, put them in the senior admin group. And then I can say, the senior admin has the capability to see the entire admin console. Junior admin has only the capability to view the deployment, but they cannot delete the deployments, okay? And the way we achieve that is by assigning predefined administrative and privileged roles. So for example, monitor, operator, maintainer, and each of these roles is essentially is a set of permissions. And the permission is on a resource, which is like JDBC resource, WAR, JMS resource. What can you do with the resource? Can you read the resource? Can you delete the resource? Can you look at the security logs? Can you look at the audit logs? And the roles are very clearly defined. What do they map to? But well, roles in terms of their actions and permissions are very clearly defined, but how do you map it into your application? That is completely up to you. So it's a very extensible architecture in that sense. Along with that comes the capability of audit logging, which is basically saying, you know, yeah, fine, I implemented RBAC, but I want some capability by which I can track, you know, who's trying to log into my system or who's trying to perform an action which they are not allowed to do. So I can do the connection and authentication events. I can even log all the management operations. At this point, they're all logged as JSON records, but there is a functionality that we're already talking about in the WildFly team where you can customize the formatting on how you want to generate these records. These JSON records could be stored in the local file, or all the more important, using syslog secured to a remote files, so that in case of a server crash, you know, you still have the audit log with you and you can trace back on what happened and why it happened. Another functionality, which would be, yeah, question.
Do you have an attack predictor
for
Say
again? Attack predictor. I can't do that.
Actually,
attack predictor
or
attack predictor,
or
we have to count
the server.
Sorry.
The mic is not working.
So you have ADAP connectors on the administrative platform, or we must declare manually the users who can see each role?
Yeah, so in the admin console, and once I walk through the demo, I'll show you how easy it is to map the users and roles. Yeah, absolutely. And in terms of administration and management, well, of course, our admin console, where you can do all of it if you're afraid of the CLI, but JBoss CLI is sort of the truth, where you can do everything using command and interface. And rather, I should say, the domain.xml or standalone.xml is where all the configuration information is stored. So whether you manipulate it using admin console, whether you manipulate it using CLI, everything is eventually persisted in your configuration files. Yeah, so there are multiple ways by which you can manage that information. One of the new features added in WildFly is the support for automated patching, which allows you to update a particular implementation in WildFly. So for example, WildFly 8 is released. REST Easy has a particular version, 3.0. Now REST Easy comes out with 3.1, and you want to update that in WildFly. So you will actually get a zip bundle, which would have the library and the metadata, with the jar and the metadata, and there will be a mechanism by which you can update a particular implementation in WildFly. Using those patches. Now, of course, this feature is more targeted towards product, where you can actually leverage this in the product and have a standard mechanism of updating binaries. You can, of course, apply one-off patches, but once a new WildFly release comes out, all of those patches effectively are invalidated. Okay? Rollbacks definitely are possible. WildFly also adds support, as I said, for core distribution. It's a small 15 megabyte download, provides a rich management layer. So it says it knows how to do management, but it doesn't do management for you. You have to guide it, you have to tell it how to do the management, what to do the management. But all the basic plumbing layer for management, deployment, class loading, all of that functionality is there. So for example, it doesn't have an admin console. It knows how to do deployment, but it you have to tell it, you know, oh, I wanted you to do war deployment, so you have to add your own deployer, and things like that. Some other features that have been added to WildFly is, of course, improved JDK 8 compatibility. So we have thousands of tests which we run regularly on JDK 8. That's a critical part. REST Easy 3, which provides JAX-RS 2 implementation, but in addition, it provides a lot of other features like, you know, JSON compression or JAXON or JSON, and all those parsers come as goodies to you. Hibernate Search, you know, is a module which is included by default in WildFly now, so you don't have to kind of bundle it by yourself. WildFly also provides per deployment security permissions, so you can, the security model in Java or in WildFly in general is not very clean at this point of time, but at least JBoss or WildFly attempts to solve it to some extent. There's a brand new public clustering API. So let's say you have created a cluster of WildFly instances. You can listen when a particular node has gone down or application has been deployed, and it throws CVI events to you, so you can build your own custom dashboard using that clustering API. Now, it's not only about addition, it's about pruning too. So Java E7 said, let's see, anybody using JB 2.1? Okay, well, if you're using for a corporate use case, I understand, but typically CMP is gone. And it's like in Java E7, it's been pruned. So is JAX-RPC and JSR-ADA. So those components do not exist in WildFly. Okay? Now, the best part about WildFly is if you want to get started, you don't have to really download it. You know, or there's a cartridge on OpenShift. You go to OpenShift, it's a free pass offering from Red Hat. That would be a completely separate session. But literally, you sign up for Red Hat OpenShift account. It's free. Go to openshift.com, sign up, no credit card. You get 3 half-gig machines, and then you say deploy WildFly. That's it. Just one button, and it automatically deploys a WildFly cartridge for you. You have a live WildFly instance running in the cloud. Okay? And of course, CloudBees also offers WildFly hosting as well. Okay. Now, before jumping into this, what I would like to do is maybe show you a quick demo, which will give you an overall view of, and maybe we don't have to jump into this at all, I'll give you a view of how you can easily set up a WildFly cluster and show some HTTP session failover over there. Okay, so all I'm going to do is, I'm going to start with a brand new instance of WildFly. Okay. I unzip it, and that's it. That's my WildFly installed. Okay. So I go here. Now WildFly could be run in standalone mode, where it was a single instance of WildFly, primarily for development, or it could be run in a managed mode, where you have multiple WildFly instances running, so you can easily create session failover capabilities. You can run multiple standalone instances, but then you have to do all the session failover, everything by yourself. So the managed domain mode where multiple instances are running is much easier for production deployment. Okay? Now, in order to if you want to run in a managed domain mode, then the idea is you have multiple physical hosts or virtualized hosts in which each host is running a particular instance or multiple instances of WildFly. Now those WildFly instances could be configured in server groups. A server group basically is what forms a cluster. Okay? That server group for me is defined in my domain.xml. So I'm saying server 1 belongs to main server group, server 2 belongs to main server group and automatically started as well. Server 3 belongs to other server group and don't start it. Okay? Now if I look at domain.xml and I can say show me main server group, that's where all my configuration profiles are stored. So here I'm saying, okay, main server group is the full profile, other server group is the full HA profile. So that's where my high availability is available. Okay? If I want to show HTTP session failover, then I want to go to my full HA profile. So in that case, I'm going to go back to my host.xml. Server 2, which belongs to my main server group, I'm going to disable that. I don't want to automatically start it. Instead, I'm going to start my server 3, okay, automatically. And I'm going to create a new server called as server 4. I just copy the lines and let it automatically start as well. So now I have other server group which has a server 3 and a server 4. Okay? So in order to start my managed domain, I can say domain.show. So this is automatically going to start my management port and it's going to start my servers in the managed domain. Oh, something is running. Hold on. Let's try it again.
Doctor set.
Say again?
Doctor set. The server 4 has the same doctor set as the server 3.
Could not create server socket. Why is it running here? I killed it. Oh, wait, that's right. Sorry, I couldn't. That's right. There you go. The way it works is by default, this is running on 8080. This is port offset 150. This is 250, and this is 350. So everything is kind of offset from that port 8080. We do that and let's kill all the Java processes and try that again. Well, that's a different error. That's a loopback error. So we don't worry about that. Yeah, that's a different error. So now I can go here and I can say, for example, go to this port, which is 1990, and it says you can't access it because in a managed domain mode, it expects you to have a user that is in the management realm. Okay, so I can go back here, open up a new window, and I can say bin add user. I'm going to add a user in a management realm, so that is a default. I'm going to call the user as admin. It's easy to guess, so let's use this anyway. And I'm going to enter a password. It says your password is simple. Yeah, keep using it. Enter the password again. I don't want it to belong to a group because that's where exactly I say, hey, does it belong to a RBAC group or I'm going to configure it for RBAC? So, yes, about the user to add in management realm, and I'm not using it in a master slave configuration. Okay? So, the user is now created. So, we cancel this guy here. And now I go back to my port 9990 and it asks me for the username and password. Now I can log in. Now here, if I look at my overview, it says server 1, server 2, 4 and 3, it shows their offsets, all that, okay? Now if I want to deploy an application which shows some session failover for me, I can click on manage deployments, add here, choose a file. So I have a file. And the sample code is checked into my GitHub repository. So I pick a WAR file that I just created. And I'm gonna add it to the repository. And then I need to assign it to a server group. So remember, the other server group was in the full HA profile. So I can select that and say save here. So this is gonna get assigned to the full HA profile. So now I can, the first one was 250 offset, so I can say A330 and I can access the app. It shows me some information data over there, timestamp, it says it's being served by node 3 or server 3, gives me session data is actually empty right now, and I can copy this URL and I can go to, for example, A430, try to access the information. So it's showing me similar information. This can be served by server 4. Okay. Now let's add a couple of attributes here. Say foo bar. I'm going to add session data, automatically gets added here. I'm going to add a couple of more attributes. Say foo 2 bar 2 gets added here. Now if I go back in my admin console here, I say show me an overview, and I just say, you know what, stop my server. So I'm going to actually server 3. I'm going to stop the server 3 here. Because that's where I added all my session data. Once I stop it here, so let's try to access this page. And it says not available. But here, if I try to access the page, the session attributes are added on server 3 or automatically available here. Now what I'm doing is port hopping. I'm manually hopping from 8330 to 8430. But if you have an LB in front of it, and you have set up mod cluster, mod JK, ISAPI, NSAPI, whatever it is, then it will automatically fail over to the next available worker. So this is a simple HTTP session failover. You have EJB failover, JMS, all those session failover capabilities exist in WildFly. Now, one last thing that I want to show you here is, for example, in my admin console here, there is a test feature where you can say, I want to run as a particular user. So I want to run as administrator, auditor, deployer. So let's say I want to run as monitor. Okay, I'm still logged in as a super user, but if I run as monitor, so I click on confirm, it's going to restart my admin console, or just the app basically. Now if I look at manage deployments, it does not show me those add, edit, deploy buttons because I'm a monitor. I can only monitor the deployments. I cannot change the deployments in any sense. Okay? If I go back here, I can say run as, and I can choose back, say as deployer. Then I can say run as again. Restarts my application. Click on manage deployments, and now I can see all of these buttons. So the idea being all that RBAC, you know, depending upon which user, which group is assigned a particular role, and how are you logging in, all that capability can be very easily defined. Now one of the questions was, where is it exactly defined? So here in the, not in the server group, I think it's in the profiles. Well, I'm missing where exactly it's defined. But somewhere in the admin console you can also define, tell the users existing, these are the users belonging to a group, this is the role that they're going to belong to. So that complete association can be very easily done in here. So in short, what I showed you the admin console, the standalone, the managed domain, the clustering, the HTTP session failover capabilities. What I didn't show you is the JBoss CLI or JBoss CLI, which is a very powerful tool for doing all of this using command line interface, where this is a lot more manual. You have to click, click, click through buttons, but JBoss CLI allows you to automate your deployments, make it a lot more solid. So you can say, hey, I played around with the JBoss CLI, I know what my commands are going to be. Now put them in a file and fire it as a batch. So for example, create my JMS resource, create my JDBC resource, deploy the WAR file, all that running the transaction. Either the whole thing succeeds or nothing. So all those kind of fancy things can be very easily done. Okay? I'm going to conclude with my skip through these slides because that's what I really talked through anyway. Yeah, this was a recent report by Zero Turnaround once again. With multiple doing support for Glassfish, now it's literally up in a plate to chop it and eat it. We have a couple of articles where we talked about Glassfish to Firefly migration. This was written by CE Jug. They wrote an excellent application which they migrated from Glassfish to WildFly. Based upon their experience, they talk about what does it take to migrate JDBC, JMS, JavaMail, security realms. They talk about all of that. And there was a recent report by, once again, by Zero Turnaround, where they're saying, migrate from Glassfish to either Tommy or WildFly slash JBoss, because you need to consider looking at an open source alternative. This is, again, a quote from there. The logical decision when migrating from Glassfish is opting for an equivalent open source alternative. In Oracle's and IBM's interest, of course, this is WebSphere and WebLogic, but those does not fit this criteria. This is, by the way, neither me nor anybody from Red Hat was involved with this report, but we were pleasantly happy. Surprised. Okay. WildFly, summary. WildFly is a fully Java E7 compliant application server. We talked about the lightweight nature of it, you know, memory footprint, disk footprint. We talked about the manageable aspects of it. We talked about the scalability aspects of it. A million concurrent connections, remember that in your mind, you know? Million concurrent connections per second. Highly scalable, fully open source. And this is from the sponsors, which is Red Hat. We are doing a conference next month in San Francisco. In Moscone, so this is DevNation, a fully polyglot open source conference. Help us spread the word. If you want to come, by all means register. This is our primary website where all the details are available. This is where all the source code for WildFly is done. You know, it's all out in the public. We have a Twitter handle. This is where JBoss EMP, which is a commercial product, is available. Tons of samples on Java E7. If you want to learn anything on Java E7, we have about 200 samples slash tests, or trillion tests, that we run here regularly as a CI job, and slide template acknowledgements. Right, my name is Arun Gupta.